Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to another edition of We Love Rare Grooves here on Monday night, coming to you live from the studios of Burbank, California on the United Broadcast Network. That's umbgo.com channel one. Also tune in to us on our Facebook Live, our YouTube channel, and Twitter here on We Love Rare Grooves. I'm your host, C-Mos, every Monday night, where we bring you the music of the magic and the magic of the music, only here on We Love Rare Grooves. As it's been said, this is where the legends can be found. And I'm happy to be here with the guests that we have in the studio live tonight, boy, because we're going to get you the history and the music and the consciousness and the awareness, only as we do here on We Love Rare Grooves with our guests. But as I say, I can't do the show without my great cast and crew. I always start off here, if my man is ready, the video. All right, that's what I'm talking about, the videologist, the one and only DJ Reg. What you say, brother?
What's going on, everyone?
What's going on with you, man? Thank you so much for this weekend, man, for making a Pershing Square Sunday brunch come to life, baby.
It was great, man. Had a great time.
All right, you and
appreciate you, brother.
I appreciate you and Big Jimmy G taking care of the groove team.
Yeah, he played Mr. MC. With his toothpick in his mouth. I didn't appreate that, but it's okay. But he was cool.
We'll give a thanks out to Belinda Jackson giving us the opportunity of the groove team to help out, as we had Lena Loy and her band along with the Super Laurie Brothers, and the previous week we had Son of Mayor and the four-time Grammy nominated winner Oscar Hernandez, making the city of Los Angeles Pershing Square Jazz Brunch goes together. So, as we only do here on We Love Rare Grooves, thank you again, my great team there, for making it happen. And then we start off with our historian, the one and only, Mr. Robert A.
Man.
You got to know your soul, baby.
Yeah.
Music of a lifetime.
Well, this is good. This special today. I think about when I was a young lad at Ohio State University. There were two areas that two people had. I had the highest level of black consciousness. One of them was the last poets. And the other one was going to be our guest tonight. These brothers were bringing fire back in the day.
Yes, indeed.
That's right. What makes it even more important is relevant today.
That is it right there.
Yeah,
that is
relevant today.
50 years.
It definitely ain't summer in America, okay? So we're going to have a good show tonight.
Without a doubt, man. And then as we do, keeping it all together, the glue, but the beautiful glue, the talented and the lovely one and only Miss Shantani Iree.
Yeah, yeah.
Hey.
Yabba dabba do.
Somebody help us get a hey from Raj. Somebody, sure, one day, send it in. How you doing, my dear?
I'm doing great.
You look beautiful as ever. You glowing?
Thank you.
Are you glowing a little bit more because of the guest tonight?
No. I didn't even know I was glowing.
Oh, yeah, you glowing.
All right. Uh-huh. Glow.
She glowing. So you ready for the show?
I'm ready for the show.
You got some great questions?
Yep.
You going to do them in 60 seconds?
No, I'm not going to do anybody in 60 seconds. No, that would be a waste of my time.
Oh, but we're going to do Shantani in 60 seconds.
Yes, that okay. We will do.
Okay, that's what I'm saying. We had to get it out there. I want to again thank everyone for tuning in every Monday night as we try to keep the show alive and artists that you request to hear, and we do the best we can. Ain't that right, Pretty Tony? Man, we do it.
he don't talk much, but he's all right. he does a lot of humming.
We want to thank Beverly Boys Production, the go-to guys for all your video production needs. Give them a call, 1-800-385-1243. And also, we got our girl from LB Tax Consulting, all year-round tax services. Give her a call at 424-227-8885. She'll get what you need. She'll deliver it to you, and she will help you file those taxes, right? And also, the Mazatlan Jazz Festival, it is coming up, man. We have been promoting this for the last 5 to 6 months, right, gang? They got Tom Brown on it, and they added Tom Brown, Rebecca J, Johnny Britt, Huge Groove, Peter Wright, Joaquin Joyner. They're all going to be in the house.
So nice.
Eric Darius, DW3, man, an exclusive Mazatlan Jazz Festival. That's right. They're ready for you. Everything is inclusive. As long as you get to San Diego, it's all inclusive. You got your airfare. It's going to get you over there. Matter of fact, I just been told by the promoter, Harold Beck, that now they got a hotel room. Nice little boutique hotel room that you get there and stay overnight. Right. But it's a four-star quality. This is the most sophisticated jazz festival on this side of the ocean. Mm-hmm. And also, we got coming up this Sunday. We just had Surface here last week. Mm-hmm. So now we're going to have Regina Bell, so Soulful Sundays, and DW3. Get your tickets. We got more information. We'll have the commercial in a minute, but get your tickets for that. This is the kickoff of Soulful Sundays. So we are excited to be involved in that. So more information to follow as we have in the show, and we might even have some tickets for you. So please give us a call, 323-524-2599. Without further ado, we get ready to get the show started with you. If you just give me 1 second there, my computer went blank. Shantani, can you help me?
Yes. So we're going to go to I was going to say we're going to go to commercial break, but no. We are going to introduce our guest.
Tonight, we have, right? We are welcome to the Groove Studios, a name that is revered by many among many musicians and DJs. He was instrumental in the development of contemporary jazz, funk, neo-soul, and has provided inspiration for generations of hip-hop and EDM producers. The Brooklyn-born, as we were saying earlier, Brooklyn, he got a little bit more part of New York, keyboard.
Flautist.
Singer, composer, and arranger may not be a household name, but his music has been heard by millions. For a 10-year span, he and Gil Scott Heron were songwriters, partners, and they were the musical architects behind the Midnight Band sound, as well as pioneering the stylish on the electric piano. He has arranged and produced for artists such as Roy Ayers.
Hey.
Earth, Wind, and Fire.
Uh-huh.
Stevie Wonder.
Yeah.
Cool in the Gang.
Uh-huh. Nice.
Will Downing.
Yeah. Will Downing.
Will Guthrie. And along with
Gwen Guthrie.
Guthrie. I'm sorry. Uh-huh. Gwen Guthrie. That's why I got you here. And some of the today's artists that are sampling and using, and he's collaborate Common, Kendrick Lamar, Gregory Porter, Christian Puma Smith, and most recently, Ali Shaheed Muhammad and Adrian Young from the Jazz Is Dead collection.
Nice.
All right,
let's give a warm welcome to the iconic, the one and only Mr. Brian Jackson. Welcome to the Groove Studio.
Hey.
Welcome, bro.
Hey, how's everybody doing? Good to be here.
Man, I feel like a breath of fresh air getting all that out, man.
You need a breath after all that.
Man, but it's without due, man. It's you, man. This is you. You're what you have done and left your mark and continuing
Absolutely.
To leave a mark on the industry that people may not realize. And we're glad that the ones that don't, they'll know tonight, and the other ones, we can celebrate that without a doubt. That's what we're going to do.
Appreciate that.
So I'm going to take it away, man. As we do in the Groove Studios, we're going to have some music tonight. We're going to have some conversation. We're going to bring it back all the way full tilt from the Rudy to the Tootie, as they say.
Rudy to the Tooter.
Tooties.
Rudy to the Tootie.
Yeah.
The Tooters.
OG conversation, Brian.
Shantani, take it away, baby.
So, Mr. Jackson, one thing I noticed is that we're both Libras. You're born the day after me.
Oh, wow.
Obviously, some years before, a little bit, of course, just a little bit. But we always ask every one of our guests, did you come out of the womb playing keyboard? And were you a flautist when you came out of the womb? What was your musical journey like?
So, I might as well have been playing when I came out because my parents, they were always playing music. So I know I had a healthy infusion of it before I even hit the ground, and it just kept on going after I came home. It was still music playing. It was mostly jazz, and I think that's kind of why I got the bug. You know, when you're exposed to something as much as I was, you're either going to be a huge fan or you're going to try to want to be involved in it in some way. So I just chose. I decided I wanted to do it myself.
Now, were they just playing music on the record player and the reel-to-reel, or were they playing, like, musicians themselves?
No, they weren't actually musicians. I mean, my mom did study a little piano. Matter of fact, I actually studied music from her piano teacher.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Piano was your first instrument?
Say that again, bro.
Was the piano your first instrument?
Okay, so the story about that is, see, my thing was I really wanted to play drums.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. That's my thing, because I was listening to Max Roach.
Uh-huh. Ah.
A lot of boom, bam, bing. You know, I was all that kind of stuff. So I wanted to do that, because back then, you didn't have no video game. So that was my video game. Whenever I would hear Max Roach drop the bomb on the bass drum or on the cymbal, that was exciting to me. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to do that. So I went up to my mom and said, yeah, I want to learn how to play drums. And she's like, that's nice. So I said, okay. So I guess that means no. And she's like, better believe it, because we in this apartment and I'm not trying to get thrown out of here. So what else you got in mind? I said, well, how about trumpet? She's like, keep going. So we settled on piano.
Now, what was the first instrument you brought home from elementary school?
Piano was the first instrument that he played.
On my back.
I mean, you remember, like, we all had to play in school. So what did you have to bring home, a clarinet, a violin, or what did you bring home?
I did not. Mm-hmm. I did not. I was so into the piano.
Really?
That, mm-hmm. Yeah, you know, because I knew I was going to practice when I came home.
Mm-hmm.
It would have been like me practicing two instruments, and it was already torture for me to just put that 1 hour in every day. But my grandmother kept me at it. You know, she said, now remember, you said that you wanted to play piano, so sit down and practice. I couldn't argue with that one. So yeah, I did say I wanted to play. So that was it. My instrument was piano. So I never got a gig in the band.
So not to age you, but you came up in the 50s and 60s in Bed-Stuy, Brooklyn. What was that like growing up music-wise as an African-American kid in New York studying music? What was that like?
So to me, there was a lot of music. There was a lot of music going on. People were always playing all around town. There was a lot of clubs.
Uh-huh.
Like in Bed-Stuy, there was the Carnet Club, Blue Carnet, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, there was the Baby Grand. Wilt had opened a club up in Harlem. I mean, it was popping. It was still popping all over in the 50s. But I was just too young to know anything about that.
Yeah.
But jazz was well appreciated all over, especially Brooklyn.
Mm-hmm.
Now, how did you come to woodwind instruments like the flute and all that? How did you come to? Was that later in junior high and high school? Or?
Yeah. So, you know, I started getting back into the thing that I really wanted to play, something where you could bend notes. Yeah, one thing on a piano, you couldn't really bend any notes.
Mm-hmm.
That bothered me a lot. So I figured I'm going to pick up a saxophone, because it was just around that time that I had started listening to John Coltrane.
Uh-huh.
Man, I want to play saxophone like Coltrane. So I went to the pawn shop. And I bought this little $20 alto saxophone.
Mm-hmm.
And dude gave me, he said, well, you need something to hang it around your neck. So he gave me basically something to hang around my neck, but it was basically like a rope. It must have been like maybe not even an inch wide.
A rope. Oh, no.
And, you know, a saxophone, it's not light.
Nope.
You know, it's not exactly heavy, but it's not light either. But you can imagine hanging that thing around your neck. Well, mm-hmm. I went everywhere with that saxophone. There's pictures of me like standing in front of the school, hiding behind a bush in front of the school playing saxophone. You know?
Aww.
People would be like, where's that coming from? Oh, yeah, it's Brian again playing that saxophone. So I played it so much that it became a part of me. That's what I'm trying to say.
Mm-hmm.
And one day I tried to lift up my arm. I tried to lift it up and I couldn't get it any higher than this. You know, hard as I tried, I could not get my arm up any higher than that. So I went to the doctor and I said, you know, doc, I can't lift my arm, you know, up any higher than this. What should I do? And he said, don't lift up your arm any higher. No. He said, oh, so what do you, are you hanging things around your neck or something? You know? And I said, well, yeah, you know, the saxophone. And he said, well, that's your problem right there. You severed your super scapular nerve.
Yeah.
Yeah. So.
Wow.
I said, so what do I do? And that's when he said, well, don't hang things around your neck anymore.
Basically.
So yeah, basically. So I, you know, but I had just been getting the fingering and everything. I was real happy about this. So one day I saw a picture of Coltrane and he had a flute. And I said, ding, that's it. So I traded in my saxophone for a flute. And I just, you know, I just played it continually. And the time came up, we were doing the bottle, and I don't think I'd ever played flute on anything before, especially after doing two albums with Hubert Laws. But just so happened that we were in the studio and we needed something to do solo. And so I had my flute and I picked it up, and that's the rest of it just kind of devolved from there, I should say.
Did you ever dabble into sports, or did you only stick to music school?
So I had one talent as far as sports were concerned. When we would play basketball, I could knock the ball out your hand.
Okay, good. A good block.
You know,
good.
I was fast, you know, yeah. And I could jump a little bit, you know, but I couldn't dunk. I never really learned how to dribble. You know, I was a mess. I was really a mess. I couldn't ever go out to practice because every time I got home, you know, I changed into my sneaks and everything, and I tried to go out, and my grandmother would be like, you got to go practice. Yeah.
So, Brian, I know you through your consciousness. When did that develop, your black consciousness and your general overall awareness? Was that early, or was that evolution at Lincoln? Or tell me about that.
Well, I think it was a combination of things, you know, because it was I started to become conscious of the world, really, around the same time that black music started to assume more of a role in black consciousness. Uh-huh. You got to realize that, like, when in 1960, I was 8 years old. So, like, 62, I was starting to understand things. By this time, Max Roach had already put out It's Time. And I had been listening to that. And I listened to WLIB a lot. The jazz station was a jazz station at the time. And Ed Williams was a master DJ. He just prepared me for jazz and to the way to listen to music and all of that. And of course, my mom used to watch the news. And on the news, almost every night, you would see some protesters, you know, you would see some civil rights marchers getting beat up and, you know, get beat in the head with batons and having the German Shepherd dogs like launched on them and fire hosed into buildings and stuff, you know, and thrown into the back of paddy wagons. And, you know, with Martin Luther King and all of, you know, the down south, and, you know, so I began to notice that all of the people that was happening to all looked like me.
Yeah.
You know, and so one day I came, I saw this button that this kid was wearing, and I didn't understand the word. And when I came home, I asked my mom, you know, what is segregation? What does that mean? And, you know, if you had seen the look on her face, she was like, okay, so now sit down, son. I got to explain some stuff to you.
Yeah.
And after she explained it to me, you know, basically she said, yeah, you know, just because of the color of your skin, you're going to find that some people just don't like you. You know, it's irrational. You know, it makes no sense. But she said, that's what happens. And that's a lot of that is going on in this country. And the people that you see that are out there in this marching and in the streets, mm-hmm. and then being beaten and arrested by cops, those are people who say, well, that's not right. That's not a valid, you know, reason to keep me from, to hate me, or to keep me from having the same things and the same opportunities that you do. And when she explained it to me, I kind of became hyper aware then of what was going on in the news. And I just got angry, you know, I just got really angry. And I had to figure out a way to express that anger.
To channel it.
I had to find some way, like some kind of steam valve, you know, where I could let it out. And for me, that turned out to be composing music.
Now, did you learn theory? Where did you pick up learning theory when you talk about composition? Did you learn that in school? Did you learn that on your own? What was some of the way, what was the direction that led you there?
Yeah, because when my teacher was classically trained, she got her master's degree in music from Spelman.
Okay. Yeah.
But she didn't know any jazz. So mm-hmm. I gone there because everybody told me, all the old folks were telling me, you know, well, if you want to learn jazz, you got to learn classical
yep.
music.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not necessarily true, but that was the standard. That was pretty much the standard operating procedure mm-hmm. at the time.
Well, that's what set you apart from the rest of the musicians out there. Is when you're classically trained, it's kind of like learning ballet first and then learning the rest of dance. You know, once you learn the base fundamentals, same thing with the way you learned piano. Piano is the foundation instrument. Once you learn piano, then everything else comes into play.
Yeah, they told me that too.
Yeah.
Learn the trumpet.
That's what set you apart.
You can play the trumpet. You can
yeah.
play So I went along with it.
So what we're going to do now is we're going to come back and start where that journey was at the Lincoln High School and how you met up. But before we do that, we want to kind of go back and talk about this latest release and let you introduce it as we get into the music of We Love Rare Grooves. And then we'll talk about that introduction to you meeting Gil Scott Heron and some of the music that we're getting ready to go into. But real quick, tell us about this Jazz Is Dead that you just released here in August of 2021, I believe.
Well, you know, I'd had a respect for Ali for many years, for Ali Shaheed from Tribe Called Quest. They were one of the first hip hop bands that I heard that really seriously were incorporating jazz and the kind of jazz that I liked and knew into hip hop. So I'd been a big fan of his for a long time. And Adrian writing these incredible scores, you know, just kind of like just jumped into the music business. I mean, and into the film business. Directing and, you know, producing and doing these film scores and everything. And I when I had an opportunity to meet them out in Los Angeles, and I understood that they were trying to do some albums with some of the elder musicians that they dug, you know, I was all for it. And so in 2019, I went to LA and we laid down some tracks together. And the one that you're going to listen to right now is one of the ones from the album Brian Jackson, JID 008, JID standing for Jazz Is Dead, and 008 being the last the eighth release on that label, and it's called Under the Bridge.
That's how we do it here on We Love Rare Grooves. Give us a call, 323-524-2599, streaming live on the UBN Network Channel 1, also our YouTube channel, Facebook Live, and also Twitter. Give us a call, 323-524-2599, and talk to the legendary, iconic Brian Jackson as we do JID. Jazz is alive, and it's dead and alive here on We Love Rare Grooves.
I'm gonna take the song from every bird and make them has got something to teach us all about being free, yeah. Jagged jigsaw pieces tossed about the room. I saw my grandma sleeping with her old straw broom, but she didn't know what she was doing. She could hardly understand. That she was really sweeping up pieces of a man. Saw my daddy meet the mailman, and I heard the mailman say, now don't you take this letter too hard now, Jimmy. They've laid off nine others today. Shadows cast by rainbows, there you'll meet the sage, feeding rabbits bits of lettuce or cleaning out the cage. He can give you more direction than you've ever known. Show you your bronze baby shoes now, my how you have grown. Ain't it nice to fly? You're waving as soft clouds go by, but you want to go exploring, you got to find some truth. You can't stand one more day of Christians shouting down at you. You say you don't dig politics, that never was your bag. People who could run for office wave their private flag. Ain't it nice to fly? You're waving as all clouds go by, but
new beginning.
Welcome back to the Groove Studios. As we have in the background there, the first minute of a new day. Boy, I cleaned a lot of seeds off them albums.
Oh, there we go.
Boy, I cleaned a lot of seeds. I seen you guys live in 78 at the David Lawrence Auditorium in the University of Pittsburgh.
Wasn't Bo Hannon on that show?
Yes.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. You remember that?
You went to the Groove that one, bro. And then Bo Hannon just passed in about the last 6 months.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Man.
Dropping like flies out here, man.
That's why we got to honor you guys now,
well,
baby.
Thank you.
You know, it's a pleasure to have you here tonight, man. And so we kicked it off and we talked about Under the Bridge, but then we start off with, I think, I call it in the morning. So you can talk about that and then go into the, you know, how you guys met Lincoln and this collaboration that went for, man, conscious minds like guys like me. I'm gonna get off me, but just for 1 second, during the University of Pittsburgh, I had a class called Black Conscious, Dr. Curtis Porter, right? And he would give us you know Curtis Porter, right? He give us extra credit for going down to the Cougar Rand, where they sold the Cougar Rands in South Africa, and give us extra credit for marching against apartheid. You can't beat that extra credit right there.
That's the kind of credit that means something.
I wish I seen they still had the picture of me carrying the sign, because that would have been classic. I digress. It's Brian Jackson here in the Groove Studios. Give us a call, 323-524-2599. Take it away, Mr. Jackson. So, yeah, we could think I'm calling. Was that from the Earth? Was that...
So, so I think I'll call the morning. That was that's one of the first batch of songs that Gil and I wrote when we were both attending Lincoln University.
I knew I had to go back.
Yeah, in Philly.
And I was trying to write some kind of more gospel-y things. I was all up into Aretha Franklin, you know, and you know, also there was this church girl that I really liked in Lincoln, and I thought, you know, if I could write a churchy song, you know, I might get some extra credit.
A whole lot of credit. I see.
He was getting his extra credit writing churchy songs. He was getting it fighting the apartheid.
Trying to get the church girl to do wrong. Okay.
Right. But what made you pick? You were in New York. What made you pick Lincoln University to attend?
Oh.
Out of all the music schools, what made you pick that one?
So I really had no intention of going to a music school. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. I figured, but one thing that my music teacher did tell me, hey, you know what? If you play music, if you can play, you can make some extra money in college.
Yes, you mm-hmm. can. Yeah.
Well, I thought about that.
Yeah.
And so that's one thing. But I was getting into so many things I wasn't supposed to be into in Brooklyn. I applied to a few colleges. I applied to, well, I had an 85 average, you know. I had been fooling around, messing around. We would go, lunchtime, we would go to the park and drink a 40, you know.
Nice.
You would start talking about Shakespeare, you know. So, I mean, I couldn't, I, I couldn't say anything. I really messed up. And all that time I had been, you know, like kind of more of like an A student. But a lot of things contributed to that. And one of the things was getting back to the whole Black movement, you know, mm-hmm. back to, you know, to the Black Power movement. And mm-hmm. it started really kind of picking up steam around that time. And I got involved in more protests. One of the protests we had at Lincoln University, at Erasmus Hall, we were trying to get a Black Studies program going. So we went out on boycott. You know, and it was just, I was kind of disillusioned with the whole educational system. And I applied to a few schools, and I only got into the two. One of them was Brooklyn College. Uh-oh. Lincoln University. So I figured I need to be as far away as possible, preferably in the sticks somewhere. And so I decided on Lincoln University.
I heard the sticks is where all the trouble usually happens.
Yeah, well, I only found that out
after the fact.
After the fact.
Yeah. But so that was. Mm-hmm.
Go ahead. No, so go ahead. So now we're at Lincoln University. And so this song that we were just talking about, bring us into that and how you got to that.
So Gil and I had recently met. We had just met because our mutual friend of ours, Victor Brown, was going to do a talent show. But, you know, at talent shows, I had no idea because I'd never been to a, you know, college talent show, much less an HBCU college talent show.
Yeah.
So what they would do if they didn't like you, not only the whistling, forget the whistling, they would throw pennies up on the stage.
Oh, my God.
I didn't know any of that until after I had already been signed up, you know, enlisted to do a version of God Bless the Child for Victor. And I said, you just doing one song? He said, no, I'm doing another one. I said, well, what's up? You know, he said, this going to play it, the guy that wrote the song. I said, what? So he introduced me to the guy who wrote the song, and it turned out to be Gil. And he played this song called Where Can a Man Find Peace? And when I heard that song, I thought to myself, I said to him, I said, you wrote this song? And he said, yeah, because it sounded like a dude that was 30 years old. Gil was 19.
Mm-hmm.
It sounded like a guy 30 or 35 years old who had written this song. You know, just the depth of the lyrics and the emotions and everything, it just blew me away. And I thought, okay, I got all these songs I was writing. Let me see if maybe he can do something with them, because my average for writing lyrics to a song was about once every 2 years.
Wow.
Except when you were trying to get extra credit.
And trying to meet the church girl.
Yeah, you need no lyrics for that, you know? It was enough, but so...
Gil had that deep voice back then, too.
That deep voice, even back then, at 19 years old, you know?
Incredible voice, man. Incredible voice.
Yeah, yeah. One of a kind.
Yes.
And I had a song. I said, man, what could you do with this one? And he said, well, what is it? You know, so I played it, and he asked me, "What?" This is kind of became my MO. He said, well, what's it about? You know, what'd you feel when you wrote it, or what does it make you feel like when you play it? Or what were you trying to say? And, you know, it kind of took me aback for a second. I was like, what? Okay, well, I guess maybe what I had in mind when I wrote it was I was thinking about the ancestors. I was thinking about,
yeah,
like all the people who had come before us,
yeah,
and fought for us, and, you know, just kind of a song that I raised my glass to.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And he said, okay, play it again. So I played it a couple more times, and he started writing some lyrics. Long story short, the end of that song, at the end, that was a song called A Toast to the People.
Now, in 1971, you did Pieces of Man. You guys did that album together, and Ron Carter was on the bass. What was that? Did you realize that at that moment, what long-term, decade-long relationship you all would have, or over the decades, relationship you would have with Gil Scott?
Not at all. I mean, you know, I figured we were going to write some music as long as we possibly could.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if I could have put a number on it, you know, but mm-hmm. I did know that, you know, that we were kind of like, whether we wrote together or not, we were friends, you know, we were best friends and we were brothers, and, you know, we were going to hang out no matter what. But whenever we hung out, we always started talking. We always started kicking it about things that were going on in the world. And, you know, one thing would lead to another. And next thing you know, we'd have another song. Mm-hmm. And it just kind of went on like that. 10 years, it didn't seem like it. It seemed like 10 minutes.
Now, I know you say you never thought that, I mean, that music really wasn't. Did you ever think you'd make a career in music? Was that your plan? What was your plan, like your backup plan, or what did you originally want to do?
My plan was just go to this school, get a degree, you know, and then get a job. Like, that was it, you know. I mean, Bill wrote his second book was called The Nigger Factory. You know? That's pretty much, you know, what I figured, let me just get myself into the system and make sure that I have my... I never really thought about being a professional musician until I got to Lincoln and ended up in 3 bands. I was in the Student Union Mixer Band, and we played top 40 R&B student mixer. And I was in an avant-garde band, and we played a lot of Miles and Coltrane. And then I was in that other band called the Black and Blues that Gil and I basically used to try out some of our new material. And they all kind of paid off a little bit. I can remember my mother calling me up and asking me, you need a care package, or you know, you need some money? And I was like, no, I'm cool.
You're like the one college kid that wasn't eating Top Ramen or something?
did y'all sign?
I went to the joint and get a hoagie every night.
Yeah.
Right, now speaking of hoagies, what was the hoagie? Did y'all have a fly hoagie spot near Lincoln?
Oh, I wouldn't call it fly, but it was the only hoagie spot. Let's put it that way. Because Lincoln University was in the middle
that's
of
nowhere.
Sticks, yeah.
Oxford University. I mean Oxford, Pennsylvania, 2 miles.
Yeah.
Away. Okay, that's where they filmed The Blob.
Okay. Oh, okay. Little history lesson. Okay, all right.
But I mean, I think they might have had 200 people in that whole town. And across from Lincoln University was a cornfield. Uh-huh. Okay, and like a little bit off to the side of the cornfield was this little place where they made the hoagies called Sissy's.
Mm-hmm. Sounds like Children of the Corn vibe, like a horror movie or something.
It's funny. I wondered why I never liked cornflakes at me.
Yeah.
And now, did you guys sign your first record deal while you were at Lincoln, or was it after?
Yeah, it was while we were at Lincoln. Gil, kind of super junior by that point, because he had taken some time off to finish his book. And me, I was just flunking out, because the thing that really upset me about Lincoln was, at the time, even though it was an HBCU, there was no real Afrocentric stuff going on there.
Wow.
You know, it was basically what I said before, you know, factory. And it's just like you were there to learn whatever the establishment expected you to learn. And, you know, and then just kind of regurgitate it over and over again. Mm-hmm. You get your job and then keep it moving. Mm-hmm. And that's not what I thought an HBCU had been about, especially an HBCU where Langston Hughes and Thurgood Marshall and Kwame Nkrumah had gone.
That's
crazy. You know what I mean? And Oscar Brown, you mentioned Oscar Brown.
Yeah, wow.
You know, but that's what it was, and I was sorely disappointed.
Wow.
And so much so that I couldn't even bring myself to go to some of those classes, man. I just ended up in the music room all the time, knowing that I knew I was going to flunk out eventually.
Wow.
Now, y'all signed with the Flying Dutchman.
Yeah.
Now, who? How did that come about? That was just a small...
Bob Thiel. You know, you see Bob Thiel's name on a lot of Impulse records.
Okay.
Archie Shepp. It's by John Coltrane.
Okay.
Yeah. He had been the most well-known producer, quote-unquote producer of John Coltrane's album. And I say that because even Bob Thiel admitted that, you know, Coltrane kind of basically taught him the ropes. You know? Like, I mean, he was great, though. He had great insight. And the thing that, one of his greatest abilities was his ability to let the music happen. And if anything, I think that's probably what Coltrane taught him.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Taught him well.
Now, when we come back, I'm dying to hear, we're going to go to a next musical section, but I'm dying to hear how your music evolved because you were so black conscious when the 70s came about. And I'm Black and I'm Proud was a big thing. Dr. King had already been assassinated. Everybody was wearing afros and natural and shingling vests. And everybody, you know, there was this whole new movement that was coming in. I would love for you to talk to us about how your music was affected and your composition was affected by that.
So give us a call, 323-524-2599, streaming on ubngo.com, channel 1, and our YouTube channel, Facebook Live. Now we're going to give a little love to coming up, the Mazatlan Jazz Festival, October 8th to 11th. You can still get your package today, $14.95. It includes your airfare from San Diego to Mazatlan. Also includes an overnight stay before you get over there. So Harold Becks is taking care of you for the most sophisticated jazz festival that's coming on. And then we're gonna do a little Beverly Boys production and give me a little bit of my girl there, Laura Burchard, with the tax consultants, all year tax services all year around. You ready, Pretty Tony? Take us away, and then we're gonna get into some more music of Brian Jackson, the legendary Brian Jackson, collaborating with Gil Scott Heron, only here on We Love Rare Grooves. Look at the professor over here, DJ Reg. He doing some professor work over here.
Little surgery.
Don't holler, Shantanee.
Don't holler about what?
The surgery he's performing.
I only holler when I have a reason to.
It might be a little messy.
Yeah, it might be.
If you want an amazing, high-quality video, definitely go with Beverly Boy Productions.
Team Beverly Boy is so dynamic.
What keeps you coming back to Beverly Boy is trust. They know what they're doing.
I look at them, you know, those guys as my team. That's my video team.
If you're considering hiring Beverly Boy Productions, just do it.
You don't really need to look much further than Beverly Boy. Give them a call. They will make sure your vision shows up on screen.
We're excited to help you with your next project, so drop us a line and let's connect.
Have become, I guess, more so than musicians, bluesicians, because we have tended to try to define certain means and modes related to the blues. We attempted to define the lie detector blues. It's caught by Mayor Frank Rizzo. I understand that he is sick currently, and we send our coldest regards. The lie detector blues and what Brian Jackson used to refer to as the ex officio blues. It's caught by Agnew, Nixon, <it's> terminal. And what we found ourselves becoming afflicted with over the past 6 months or so is the bicentennial blues. Some people think that America invented the blues, and few people doubt that America is the home of the blues, because the bluesicians have gone all over the world carrying the blues message, and the world has snapped its fingers and tapped its feet right along with the blues folks, but the blues has always been totally American as apple pie, as American as the blues, as American as apple pie. The question is why? Why should the blues be so at home here? Well, America provided the atmosphere. America provided the atmosphere for the blues.
Drink of water.
Welcome back to the Groove Studios. We're live with the one and only. Look, he's smiling, man, bringing back those memories. Only was done by Brian Jackson and Gil Scott Heron. The consciousness, the level of what you guys derived in of the jazz and the neo-soul that they call it now, and that jazz fusion, you know, along with the poetry and the storytelling behind it, man. And it was one thing people, I was talking to someone and I said, I was having Brian Jackson on, no offense, and they were like, I said, Gil Scott Heron, if you got a Gil Scott Heron, you see Brian Jackson.
Yeah.
And that's one thing he gave you credit for, make sure that you were part of it as a arranger and a producer, even though the voice wasn't there sometimes because everybody just hear the voice. But you're on the flute, in the bottle, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm.
I'm all over there.
All over it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, you know, I always say that the record business can only, you know, can only count up to one. So, you know, I mean, it's pretty much how it goes. You know, they like to focus on, you know, on one person, but the truth is that you know, all music is an effort by a lot of people.
It's a recipe, because if you don't have all the ingredients,
that's right,
you don't have all the ingredients, you can't make it. So you guys was like the cayenne and the pepper. Right?
Now, when we left off, we were talking about you getting signed in college. You had your first record deal, or you guys signed in college. You talked about the lack of consciousness in the HBCU that you went to. But now we're in the 70s. Dr. King has already been assassinated. Robert Kennedy. We're going into Vietnam. All of these things are going on, and Black people are Black and proud and wearing afros. How was your music? How did your music evolve during that time? Because you guys had quite a bit to write about at that time.
We didn't, I mean, that's the thing though. I mean, we're caught up in it. I mean, it didn't really, we didn't consciously set out to say that we were going to, you know, write songs about any one particular thing. It's just that we noticed a lot of things in our environment and we wrote about them. So it just turned, it just so happened that when it came time for us to produce our first album, Winter in America,
mm-hmm.
the kind of the theme behind it was it was originally supposed to be like an audio novel, and it was supposed to be about this brother who had just come back from the war, while he was over there, he ended up addicted to heroin, and he had like crazy PTSD,
yeah,
and destroyed him his relationship with his family, and you know, that's why he had to leave his home, and that was Your Daddy Loves You. Peace Go With You, Brother was about him trying to find acceptance after coming back from the war, you know, because a lot of veterans came back from the Vietnam War.
Right.
They were kind of really disrespected, you know, because they fought in that war, which was so unpopular.
Right. Yeah. And the war was never won.
That's right. Never was.
And the war was never won.
Or since then.
Mm-hmm.
Now, it says, I was looking up on here, and it said that in 1974 was the first time that you received co-billing. And it's interesting because Barney Hoskins described Uncut as a masterwork of ghetto melancholia and stark political gravitas. What does that mean to you?
Well, I guess what I'm taking away from it is that we were depressed. we were young black men in America in the 70s, looking at like a lot of our brothers being killed overseas, and a lot of our brothers and sisters, you know, being killed over here, and things not really progressing. After having seen our leaders like Malcolm X and Dr. King assassinated, things weren't really improving. And then there was Kent State.
Mm-hmm.
Oh yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Kent State, and then there was Jackson State.
Yeah.
Mm. All of these things, we just felt like we were at the beginning of the end. Uh-huh. Hence the title Winter in America.
And the Orangeburg Massacre at the same time down in South Carolina. Well, I wanted to ask you, what I always felt you had is a pulse on black life, okay? At a whole bunch of different levels, consciousness level, alcohol, family, the whole bit. How was it in about 2 years you guys blew the beep up? How was that adjustment for you? Because you became kind of like rock stars.
Yeah, it was weird.
it was weird.
Because first of all, we did the bottle.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It was kind of, to us, that was a fun, it was kind of a fun song to do. But it was, I guess if you look at, like, say, Bobby McFerrin, for instance, you think about all the music that he's done. But the thing that he's most known for is Don't Worry, Be Happy. It was kind of like the same thing with us in a way, because if we were to be taken seriously at all, we never figured that we were going to be most known for, for the bottle.
Mm-hmm.
But that's what happened. And Clive Davis was hot on Gil to try to get some more bottles.
You want more bottle music?
Literally.
Want some more bottles, man. But that wasn't happening. That wasn't where we were coming from. That wasn't our frame of mind. Mm-hmm. We weren't trying to recreate or reproduce anything that we had already done. We were trying to do something different every time we set out.
Now, by 79, you guys had 10 albums that you guys recorded. So how did you come to start working with Earth, Wind, and Fire and Stevie Wonder and Gwen Guthrie and all of them?
Okay, so I have a confession to make.
Uh-oh.
Long time ago, right? When I started doing my own bios, I put them in there. I never really per se worked with Earth, Wind, and Fire. What happened was
yeah. The truth comes out on Rare Grooves.
Yeah. What had happened was, go ahead.
They had an Earth, Wind, and Fire Day in L.A. years ago. Me and Tom Bradley. Fire Day. And they were going to do a show at Hollywood Bowl, and we were going to do one in San Francisco and a bunch of other places. And they asked them, like, who do you want on your show at the Hollywood Bowl? You can have anybody you want. And they said, well, we want Weather Report.
Oh, yeah.
Gil Scott Heron and Brian Jackson. And so through that, we did that show and we did one in San Francisco. We ended up doing a couple more shows opening for them, you know, and Weather Report. Opened some other things for Weather Report too. And then that turned into opening for Herbie Hancock and a bunch of things like that. And as far as Stevie is concerned, well, that's also a stretch, because what happened is that we were playing the bottom at the Roxy one day, and all of a sudden, like the crowd just started to part, like the, you know, like the Red Sea, you know.
Uh-huh.
And, here was Stevie coming down the aisle, and he gets up on stage, and he goes over to the drummer, and he says, "Get up."
Yeah, he's known for doing that.
And you know,
and he got up.
And Stevie started throwing down on the bottle.
So. I know. Stevie probably told him to modulate.
Oh my god.
Hey. One of the two.
Hey, we got a caller. One second. We want to take a caller. We got a caller.
Let's do it.
Thanks for calling We Love Rare Grooves. Who do we have on the line?
Hello.
This is Sherry Brown.
Hey, Sherry.
Hey, everyone. And, oh, my gosh, I'm enjoying the show and the memories. Oh, my goodness.
Man, don't it bring back the memories, Sherry?
Are you having flashbacks of the 70s?
Wearing a dashiki.
Oh, my gosh, with my dashiki and my little natural.
She said a little natural.
It was actually kind of big.
I remember.
My gosh. And so I texted Brian. I mean, let me tell you, I was introduced to you all. You know, I'm in high school, right? I think I was in the 9th grade, yes. And I would stop after school on the way home. I'd get off the bus and go to my favorite record store when there were records and we were buying vinyls. And so I go into the record store with one of my really good friends that, you know, in my class. And we both get off the bus and go on. And there's this really cute salesman, you know, you're a high school young girl. And it's like, you want to impress. And, oh my gosh, look how cute he is. So, I'm trying to act like I know who he is, or that I'm noticing him. And I'm looking through the racks of albums. And he says, you ladies want to hear a new album that's really good? And we said, yes. He said, and he's my brother. And so I looked at it and it said, Gil Scott Heron, Pieces of a Man.
Wow.
And I said, okay, I'm going to buy it. And I bought it just because I was trying to impress. And, oh my goodness. I took that album home. I listened to it. I took it to school the next day and made all my friends sit in the library and listen to this album in headphones. And it was, oh my gosh, I learned Revolution Will Not Be Televised. Oh my gosh, I learned all the lyrics, and I would play these kungas. And at the same time I'm playing the kungas, I would recite the Revolution. You will not have to stay home, brother. You know, with my long dashiki. and it was so effective. They actually, I'm in high school, right? And the colleges have me on tour reciting this poem while I'm playing these kungas and this long dashiki that my mom sold for me. So that's a bit of history for me. This is such, in Pieces of a Man, oh my gosh, it's such a beautiful album.
Wonderful. You got people writing buying records and writing gospel songs to pick up people.
There you go. Well,
a page out of y'all book.
It is. Thank you, Sherry, so much for calling the show. Thank you for being a part of the show.
Yes.
She's a great guitarist herself, Brian. She's played with Patrice Rushen. She's been on our show, too. So thank you, Sherry, for continuing to support as we support you.
Hey,
Love Rare Grooves.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you all for doing what you do. And Brian Jackson, thank you.
Yeah. I need to recognize
him. Good night.
Good night.
Yes.
Hey, Brian, during that time, like they were saying earlier, you guys have been all over the world when you were performing, when y'all became, you know, successful and hot out on tour. Where did you not go? Did you go, at that time, we're talking about early 70s, did you get to go to Africa to perform at all?
South Africa, no.
No. Not during the 70s.
Yeah. Didn't you go to?
No.
Nobody was going there.
It was our apartheid in.
Yeah. After we had got back together briefly, mm-hmm. and we went over to Johannesburg.
Yeah.
What year was that?
That was September. That was September 98.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right. After and, the apartheid. Yeah.
We said, well, let's do Johannesburg, and we played Johannesburg over there. You know, tears coming out of my eyes. You know, I'm thinking, yeah, we're gonna, you know, when we get to the part, what's the word?
Uh huh.
Yeah.
It was resounding, you know, Johannesburg. And so we got to that part, you know, and it's like, what's the word? And I couldn't see in the audience, but I didn't hear anything. You know, I just heard a couple people looking around like, what's the word?
You guys don't know the word?
Don't know the word, you know. So after the show, I said to a brother, I said, well, what's up, man? I mean, you know, your guys didn't like that song?
It's iconic.
He said, well, no, you have to understand. Only a few people knew that word. Perfect. That song.
Thank you.
Because
yeah.
It wasn't South played.
Africa, when it came out, it was banned.
And yeah,
right, that's right. They didn't hear the song when it came out.
Oh, wow.
And think about it. You know, the records ain't going to, you know, after a while, they're not going back to play it for it. You know, wow.
Mm-hmm.
So there's that, you know.
One other thing. Tell me about Saturday Night Live.
We appeared on Saturday Night Live kind of really around the first time that it one of the few first times that it
debuted.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, no, I said I remember it so well.
Yeah, it was 75.
Mm-hmm. And that was when Eddie was starting out and he was on there.
No,
no,
he wasn't even on there yet.
Oh heck no,
Eddie was 13.
Was he?
Yeah.
Wow.
Oh. Yeah.
Garrett Morris.
There you go.
Oh okay.
Yes, Garrett Morris.
The only black person there.
Only one.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And a Chevy Chase.
Yeah.
John Peach. Yeah. That's right. They all got their start.
Radner.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, all of those guys. Bill Murray. And so, was Bill Murray? Yeah, anyway. So the guest was Richard Pryor.
Oh, y'all did that
wow.
one.
Wow.
Y'all so, did that
so he
one.
Hosted? Richard Pryor hosted?
No.
Richard Pryor hosted.
He hosted. Host it, right. Yeah, that's the one he hosted does. When they he host. Was the president. He yeah. played the part as the president during a press
wow.
conference. Remember, he played the press conference president.
I have to go watch that.
Yeah.
Also, he played Landshark, you know.
Right.
Yeah.
And was that the one with The Exorcist?
Yes. Oh. Yes. Yes.
That is so iconic.
Yeah. Linda Blair and The Exorcist.
Yeah.
Psychiatrist, you know,
yeah.
with the
yeah.
work. Yep, yep.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's the only thing that got me through The Exorcist was listening to Richard Pryor when he said it wouldn't be no black people in the movie. As soon as the devil spoke, we'd have been gone. As soon as he spoke, hello, we'd have been like,
hello,
goodbye.
Bye.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Just quick to wrap it up. So everybody gets to choose their own musical guest when they're on.
Oh.
And
oh, okay.
Wow.
Scott Heron, you know, to perform. Uh-huh. And they said no. And he said, what you talking about? You know, everybody gets to choose who they want. And I say, Gil Scott Heron. So it's going to be Gil Scott Heron, or it's not going to be me either.
Oh.
Damn. That's what power is about.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It really is.
So I guess they got away from that because I don't think the guests are choosing the artists that are coming on now because I know ain't nobody.
Well, it's not
choosing.
Even the same Saturday Night Live anymore. It's
I know they ain't trying to little whatever his name is.
Who?
No, Lil not the little guy that anyway.
Lil
we getting off.
I don't know.
Lil Nas X.
Yeah. Anyway, continuing on as you traveled around. Where did you guys not go that you would have loved to have went to?
Oh, I would have loved to go to Africa before then. You know,
okay, right.
To anywhere. I mean, the only place that we actually played outside of the States was the UK and France.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah, so we had missed a lot of places. You know, we had missed Spain and
Switzerland,
you know,
and all those places. That
South
have,
America.
Yeah. Wow.
South America, my gosh. Yeah, we would have loved it. I would have loved to have played Cuba.
Yeah. Brazil.
But we weren't going to Cuba then. So
we ain't going to Cuba now.
Oh, y'all, people are going back now.
And not for no concerts.
Mm-hmm.
Oh yeah, you should get Big Red. Should get over there. They open now. It's over. Get over there, Big Red.
Let's do a show.
Brian, you said let's do a show. Don't get me started, boy. Big Red, 9 to 5.
Now, where were you all when you first heard your song on the radio?
You know, I'm not sure, but I know I can tell you where my grandmother was. She was in front of Burdell's at the in Brooklyn on Fulton Street, and she called me up. She said, "I just heard your record on
BLS.
On the record player," she said, "outside of
Burdell's record store.
And I said, "Oh yeah, so what'd you do?" She said, "Well, of course, I went in," and I said, "That's my grandson."
Classic.
Yes, what else was I going to do?
Oh, that's sweet. Now, what was the car that you bought when you started making money? Because you said you weren't a broke college kid. So when you started making money, for real, what was the first car that you bought? Or what was the money car that you bought?
Okay, so I did buy, I was always buying used cars, mm-hmm. you know. So let me see. My mom's actually, like, my dad had bought my mom a car, and she never drove. She was scared to drive it, so he gave it to me. She gave it to me. It was a
That's
Chevy
a New Yorker.
Nova.
It was a Chevy what?
Chevy Nova.
Nova. Oh, I remember the Chevy Nova. Yeah.
It was sporty, you know. But the first car that I bought for myself, that I really considered, you know, like I'm really like doing it. Now, was a 240Z.
Yeah. I had one myself.
240Z.
Yeah.
That was sporty, man. That was sporty, though.
No, that's sporty. Okay.
White leather interior.
Mm-hmm.
So, hey, we're going to go into another musical selection, but when we come out, we want you to think of your top five. We usually see, I don't know, would it be arranger, composer, or would it be a pianist?
Pianist.
Pianist. Okay.
Pianist.
Pianist. You know, of your top five. Also, a tale from the tour bus and some of the best advice you receive for the music industry.
Okay.
And then we're going to do Shantani in 60 seconds. She'll have a roundabout questions for you as we come in. So we're going to go into another musical selection. But before that, we're going to do the Mazatlan Jazz Festival that is coming up October 8th to the 11th, brought to you by Harold Bex. He is the promoter for the most sophisticated jazz festival this side of the hemisphere. It's going to be a great event that's coming up with outstanding artists, host of things to do, from golfing to massage. If you take somebody down there and you dating and you don't get none, you're in trouble. Because this is a,
you know, it could happen. You could do all of that and still not get any. I mean, no one's obligated to give you.
But it's the atmosphere that makes you embrace this. Yeah, the atmosphere is going to just make you want to make like the elastic in your panties melt.
Atmosphere. Right. Oh, just okay. That's what I mean. So then you shouldn't have to do no work.
Right. That's what I mean. Because then you're going to have the jazz concert, the villas, everything, the flight down there. So it's just going to be an amazing day. Pretty Tony, take me away. Mazatlan Jazz Festival
much the people wanna know. Won't you blow, wind, blow?
Fly, breeze, fly, like a symbol of a change. Fly, breeze, fly, 'cause only you can conquer time. Fly, breeze, fly, between the sun. There's a need for peace, ooh, written on everybody's face. Won't you fly, please fly?
You alone have been to Africa.
Welcome back to the Groove Studios. We found writing credits for this. Is this one that they threw in on Cool in the Gang?
No.
That's legit?
Yeah, that's legit.
Man. Right, that's legit. And then Roy Ayers.
I did that session.
Hey, earlier we skipped over one that we didn't talk about. Freedom Serade, a tribute to Paul Robeson featuring Brian Jackson. Remember that?
Oh, man.
Did we reach in the Groove Studios for that one?
Spontaneous Simplicity, man. Right. Those boys down in D.C., mm-hmm. man. I think Malone was the singer on that, man. Just recently passed away. Mm-hmm. And Alan Barnes, who used to be a member of the Blackbirds.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Okay. Alan didn't pass, did he?
Yeah, he did, man.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Years ago.
By the way, TNT has run a month of Paul Robeson, Old Turner. Paul Robeson's films all month, man, and I got him just incredible, man, at an incredible time.
He was definitely way ahead of his time.
All American, operatic singer, and a freedom fighter.
So we did that. We went into Groove Studios. Did we go into Groove Studios for that one?
You sure did. You went in deep.
So, as we said earlier, y'all want to do Shantani in 60 seconds, then we'll get back to the questions, and then we're going to go to my favorite part of the show when we do the samples and our Dusty of the Week and sharing the information. So, we get ready to go on a whirlwind tour here. We're going to get it all in.
Yeah, okay, wait.
Yeah.
All right.
So, I'm going to ask you a random series of questions. You have to answer them in 60 seconds or less. Don't let Clifton distract you. Just fire out the answers.
I will distract you.
It's an obstacle course. I get it. Yeah.
Hold on, I'm coming. Give me a second.
I feel that's the story of your life. Is that what you tell your wife all the time? That poor thing.
Wow.
I'm coming. Just give me a second. Just kidding. This is a family show. Mr. Jackson, what was your first job?
Oh, working for a community center.
Your favorite song to perform?
The Bottle.
Name a lover gave you. What is a name that a lover has given you?
Honey Cakes. Slow Robert. Motion.
What?
Robert.
Okay.
Oh, greatest piece of advice?
Get your publishing.
Ah, I was born in 1984. What on earth were you doing then?
We were smoking weed together, right?
I don't remember. I have no recollection.
Because we were smoking weed together.
If you could record or produce an album for a celebrity that is deceased, who would that be?
Tupac.
If you hadn't made a career in music, what would you have done instead?
Electronic engineer.
If you hadn't made a career... I'm sorry. If you could live again as an animal, which one would it be?
An elephant.
Oh, which superpower would you want? Invisibility, flying, or reading minds?
Flying.
Dream artist to work with that is alive?
Thundercat.
If you were in trouble with your girlfriend, which song would you play?
I think I'll call it morning.
That's good. You did well. That's it. See? It wasn't so bad. He doesn't remember 84, huh?
Well, you know, at least that's my story.
There you go.
So give us the top five that we were asking about, composers, arrangers.
Of all time.
Okay. Pianists. So high up on that list would be Quincy Jones.
Of course, yeah. Yes.
You know, because I started thinking about the consistency, you know, the level of consistency. I mean, Quincy.
Over time.
All the way from dying in Washington and, you know, all the way up to, you know, to now. Mm-hmm. Even. So Quincy, Ahmad Jamal, one of my favorite and pianists and probably one most influential ones. Roy Ayers, same thing. Yeah. Consistency.
Yeah.
He continues to do it over and over and over again. And the music he does is simple, but it's deceptively simple, you know, and it's simply deceptive because, you know, it's just nobody else has that sound. He can put chords together and you automatically know that it's Roy Ayers. It's a Roy Ayers song. Stevie Wonder, same thing as far as consistency is concerned. You know, just to be able to write as so many hits over and over again. It's just, to me, it's amazing. And then finally would be as an arranger, as a team of arrangers, Thad Jones and Mel Lewis. Their big band was absolutely like it was a miracle. And they used to play every night down at the Village Vanguard in Greenwich Village. Mm-hmm. And I got to check them out a couple of times. And I'm telling you, you've never seen anything like that.
Did you ever go to Studio 54 or perform there or do anything there?
Do anything there?
I'm just being nosy, yes. Do anything there, yes. Anything at all. I'm just curious. Our viewers, inquiring minds would like to know.
Yeah, no, I passed by Studio 54 a couple of times. I know where I knew who it was.
You knew how to get there, of course, for sure.
All right, there. We get right going to the Dusty of the Week here. The Dusty of the Week is brought to you by Sweet Life SoCal Concierge Digital Magazine. The editor is Miss Sarah Harris. And man, it's a great magazine. You can go online.
You said that perfect. Wow.
Now I'm all messed up. It's a great digital magazine. Faces of Love, Heritage Suite, Lifestyles, Faith and Purpose, and also Travel Leisure. So go log on, be a part of it, be a part they send out to all their subscribers every Monday. An example of who we have on as a guest. So we partner with them, so we're helping them get more people to sign up, register, be a part of the Sweet Life SoCal family. So sweetlifesocal.com and register today. So today, as she will describe, our Dusty of the Week is usually a song that we have
that we pulled out of our grandmother or our mother's basement and blew the dust off of.
So today, the Dusty of the Week, we're going way back. I'm gonna go by his government name and see if you know him by his government name. His government name is Herman Poole Blount. You don't know?
I don't even know who that is. Wait a minute, hold on. I had to look.
And he's from Birmingham, Alabama, but he's better known as Sun Ra. Did we get a dusty on you for that one? You know, Sun Ra was American jazz composer, band leader, piano, synthesizer player, and poet. And he put in that instrumental music that the cosmic and the philosophy and the prolific output and member theatric performances is not,
he was just
no
floating.
One. Right. And what's the, don't you got a story behind, didn't y'all meet Sun Ra? Can't hear you. Can't hear you.
He's muted.
Who's muted? You're muted.
He is.
Okay. Yeah. Sorry about that. Yeah. So I do have a story about Sun Ra. So early on in when we started writing together, Gil and I found out that Sun Ra was going to be appearing in Philadelphia, which is actually where he was based. So we went to check him out. And I mean, Sun Ra to me was like bigger than, you know, he was just bigger than life. But at the same time, I really wanted to meet him. You know, I wanted to know, like, what's this brother about? You know, where's he, you know, where's his head at? And how could he tell me? I figured if anybody could tell me how to get where I wanted to get to musically and spiritually, it would be Sun Ra. So I went up to him after the show. He was just standing in the lobby, you know, just chilling. And I came up to him and I said, excuse me, brother, but, you know, like the thing I would really like to know is, and then I just kind of blanked out, right? I'm like, all of a sudden I realized, wait a minute, I'm talking to Sun Ra. You know, what could you actually say? So I just said, can you just tell me anything? I'm like, I'm a writer, you know, I'm a musician. Can you just tell me anything about how to do this or anything? And Gil saw him and he was coming. And I said, I kind of told him, come on, man, hurry up. It's Sun Ra, getting ready to say something, you know? And so he kind of ran up, right? And as Gil was walking up, he looked at Gil and he looked at me and he said, two black men with the same goal can't be stopped.
Sun Ra.
Sun Ra.
And take me away, Pretty Tony. Give me Sun Ra, the beginning. We only need 1 minute, Tony, 1 minute.
Space is the place.
You're a moron. If you like yo, let me ask you something. tres, cuatro. You see that black boy over there running scared? His old man in a bottle. He done quit his 9 to 5. He drink full time and now he's living in a bottle.
Go ahead.
See that black boy over there running
scared? Let's do it.
I know I said a lot of things that I ain't need to say, but today is a new day, and you know I rep my city, I'm in green and gray. Flyer than the sky, I'm a solar system. Call diamond supply when I need a lay. I wonder why they lie when they know we listening. If he was alive, what would Jesus say? Some Jewish, some Muslim, and some Christian. One nation under God, we gon' make a way. They tryna build a mass cheer next to ground zero. Y'all need to stop being weirdos, let them people pray. Hey, stupid is a stupid does. How can an educator burn books? We were innocent kids turn crooks. Now we tryna make it to the street.
Still live in the past.
essence of a black life lost in the hourglass.
This is your life, Mr. Brian Jackson. Did you enjoy?
I definitely did. I never knew Peniston.
Sample. I seen your face. You got in that camera like, did I get my paper on that? Did we get our cut on that one? And then she got Steve Hilks.
You got your receipts on that?
On Steve Silk Hurley and CeCe on that one?
Real. Wow, man. That took me out.
We got you?
Yeah, you got me. You got me. That was a good one.
So, Matt.
Talking about Dusty. Uh-huh. You know, Dusty, I thought you was going to put out a picture of me with, bring out a picture of me when I was wearing Jerry curls.
Yeah. Oh, you went through the Jerry curl phase.
You went through a Jerry curl phase?
I was playing with Cool in the Gang, yeah.
Oh, really? I didn't find that one, man. I did not find it. Because
you skipped that Jerry curl fade, didn't you?
Yeah, I skipped Jerry curl. I went straight to a fade. From fro to fade.
I wish I had.
Man, were you dripping all over the place?
Dripping all over the place.
One of our number one fans said, Colleen Jenkins, thank you so much for being in the groove. Stewards, is it any unreleased Gil music that you will be sharing or will share or have?
Unfortunately, that's not up to me.
Okay.
Well, that's not his wheelhouse.
Right. Well, we were just asking a question for our guests. So, man, what are you got coming up here in the future? What you doing? Give us some updates. I know you've been doing some other things. You got any shows coming up? How people can stay in touch with you on social media?
Okay. So, first thing off, you can definitely, I think I'm more active on Instagram than anywhere else. It's Brian_Jackson on Instagram. So it's your 2 underscores. And I'm the same thing on Twitter, actually. Facebook, you can find me at brianjackson.official. As far as, and my website is brianjackson.net. So, you know, you can keep up with me there as well. But I would say probably IG is the best way to, you know, stay in touch with me. As far as tours are concerned, it looks like I might be doing some stuff. I mean, we've been putting it off for the last couple of years, obviously. Mm-hmm. But, I think probably by the spring, looks like I'm scheduled to do some stuff over in Europe.
Okay.
Overseas. And with a couple of things coming down the pike for LA. I'm really trying to see if I can get Mr. Ron Carter and Mr. Bernard Purdy and Mr. Hubert Laws to come.
Oh, wow.
Right.
Come on, Big Red.
I've been trying to get Hubert on the show, too. You know?
Yeah, we've had Ronnie and we've had Ella?
Eloise.
Eloise. We've had them.
Yeah. Oh, yeah?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we had Ronnie twice.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, of course, yeah. So, you know, that would be great if we could get something like that together, a little reunion. So, you know, I'm just putting that out there. And
well, if you want me to coordinate, I can coordinate like Fred Sanford.
Oh my God.
All right, then. Come on with it. And
we'll talk offline.
We got another couple of albums coming out on the BBE label, which is over in London. Got an album that I'm doing basically all singing, which I said I wasn't going to do. And my producer, Daniel Koyas, who produces and is a member of the Phenomenal Hank Band, he got me into the studio and we wrote a bunch of songs together, most of which I'm singing on. It's called This Is Brian Jackson. That's going to be coming out. I'm not sure, actually. I got to check with them to see if it's
coming out. So you want to do the world release on our show?
All right. Okay.
I'm just putting it out in the atmosphere.
That sounds pretty good.
I mean, you think we can handle that? I mean, you know, you legendary, iconic, man. We just a little old show here.
I think you can handle it. Yeah, let's do that. That would be great. That would be awesome. And then I got another thing that I did with Eric Hilton of Thieves Incorporation was the producer on that.
Really? Okay.
The Archives, you might have heard of them. They did a reggae tribute album to Gil Scott, the music of Gil Scott Heron and Brian Jackson. And you might think a reggae cover, you know, covers of Gil Scott Heron Project, it really works.
Okay.
It's called Carry Me Home, and man, if you get a chance, check it out. It's a really great album.
Okay. All right.
So I did something with them as well, and so that'll be coming out next year too. So I've been busy.
I see. Well, yeah. Stay with us, man. You're part of We Love Rare Groove family as we are in Groove Overtime. Our engineer over here is, shutting the lights down and everything so we can get out of here. So from the team here, the engineer, Pretty Tony, Jimmy G in the house with us. So DJ Reg, the consultant, Robert A., Shantani, and myself, we want to give you the We Love Rare Grooves Award, as we do to all our guests.
Hey!
And since you guys are not in studio, sometimes we just can't coordinate it the way we need to, so expect something in the mail soon you only, as you deserve it.
I'll display it with pride.
Uh-huh. And thank you for an incredible career.
Yeah,
I mean,
sure.
Incredible. You know how sometimes you just need to go up there and pump your chest, but, bro, you've been doing it for a long time and been doing it well.
So glad you went to Lincoln University in the sticks.
There you go.
Hey, man, we appreciate you. You're iconic. You're a legend. You're still going on. Hopefully we come out here to L.A. We can have some fun, share that award with you, take some photos with you, and keep doing what you're doing, man, because it's a wonderful thing you're doing, man. Thank you. You're part of the Groove family now, man.
All right. Thank you. And proud to be. Thank you.
So there you go.
The replay of the show will be up. And
yep, on our YouTube channel, We Love Rare Grooves. We Groove Entertainment is our Instagram channel. You can follow us on the Twitter, and you can catch the audio replays of our shows on iHeartRadio, Spotify, and Apple Music Podcasts.
So I want to thank our team, DJ Reg, Shantani, Robert A., the consultant, Jimmy G. in the house supporting us as always, and our engineer,
Pretty Tony, the owner, the engineer.
So as we close out, man, they got Soulful Sunday coming up this week. Look on my page. If I get the okay, we might have some tickets. Soulful Sunday is kicking off with Surface, Regina Bell, DW3, in the house at the Globe Theater here in Los Angeles. You got to be there. It's going to be a concert series that's coming up strong. Pretty Tony, take me away so the folks know how to get their tickets as we close out here on We Love Rare Grooves with Soulful Sunday. We want to thank Mr. Brian Jackson. Hear that in the background, boy. That's you, baby. Getting it done, man. Love it. Love it. Love it. As we only do here on
We Love Rare Grooves.
Good night, everybody.
See you next week with Ben Tankard.
Don't go nowhere.
Don't go nowhere at all. We got Mr. Ben Tankard in the house, the godfather of gospel jazz, only here on We Love Rare Grooves.
Get ready, Los Angeles, for an intimate, up-close, and personal concert experience with your favorite R&B legends. The Soulful Sundays Live Concert Series kicks off October 3rd at the iconic Globe Theater in downtown L.A., featuring Regina Bell. With special guests, Surface,
only you can make me happy,
and DW3. Don't miss the Soulful Sundays Live Concert Series featuring Regina Bell, Surface, and DW3, Sunday, October 3rd at the iconic Globe Theater. For tickets and information, call 562-760-6166. That's 562-760-6166. Or online at ctickets.us. That's SEETickets.us. The Soulful Sundays Live Concert Series, October 3rd through December 19th. Hosted by Tyrone Dubois. Presented by RDMJ Entertainment.